Hi friends, welcome to the channel Dinesh. Here we are discussing about some important questions and answers that will help for preparing NIMHANS and upcoming Kerala PSC DME exams. So if you are not subscribed to our channel, please subscribe. We will go to the topic: important nursing questions and answers. First question: the stage of labor begins with the birth of the child and ends with the expulsion of placenta. The stage of labor begins with the birth of the child and ends with the expulsion of placenta. Options: first stage, second stage, third stage, fourth stage. Correct answer is third stage. First stage is starting from complete dilation of cervix up to complete dilation of cervix, that is 10 centimeter dilation. Second stage starting from the complete dilation of cervix and the delivery of child. Third stage is starting from the birth of the child up to the expulsion of placenta. Then one more stage is there, fourth stage, that is known as recovery stage, that is starting from delivery of placenta to 6 weeks. So that these are the steps of delivery. First stage, that is complete dilation of cervix. Second stage, delivery of the child. Third stage, delivery of placenta. Fourth stage, delivery of placenta up to 6 weeks, that is recovery stage. Next question: the uterine discharge during the first 1 to 4 weeks of puerperium is called. The uterine discharge during the first 1 to 4 weeks of puerperium is called. Discharge, lochia, rupture of membrane, none of these. The correct answer is option B, that is lochia. After the delivery, first 3-4 days, the lochia will be red in color. That red color lochia is known as lochia rubra. That will be dark red in color. Lochia rubra in dark red color. That will be the duration of the lochia rubra 3 to 4 days. Then after 4 days, the color will change into pinkish brown. Lochia color will change to pinkish brown. That color lochia is known as lochia serosa. Lochia serosa will be there for 4 to 10 days. First lochia rubra 3 to 4 days, then lochia serosa, that is pinkish brown, 4 to 10 days. Then again color will change to white. The lochia color will change into white color, that is known as lochia alba. That lochia alba will extend from 10 to 28 days. So these are the three kind of lochia: lochia rubra, lochia serosa, lochia alba. Lochia rubra, dark red in color, it will be there 3 to 4 days. Lochia serosa, pinkish brown color, 4 to 10 days will be there. Then finally lochia alba, that is whitish yellow color, 10 to 28 days will be there. Next question: the reverse tick sign in ECG suggestive of which condition? The reverse tick sign in ECG suggestive of which condition? Diazepam toxicity, cardiac arrest, digoxin toxicity, verapamil overdose. Reverse tick means normally tick will be like this. So reverse tick means it will be like this. So reverse tick sign in ECG suggestive of which condition? Correct answer is digoxin toxicity. In digoxin toxicity, there will be reverse tick sign or reverse check sign. The therapeutic range of digoxin, that will be 0.5 to 2 nanogram per milliliter. The digoxin toxicity considered if digoxin serum level exceeds 2 nanogram per milliliter. Therapeutic range, that is extends from 0.5 to maximum 2 nanogram per milliliter. If it is more than 2 nanogram per milliliter, it is known as digoxin toxicity. One of the peculiar feature of the digoxin toxicity, that is reverse tick sign. I will show you the ECG. So this is the reverse tick sign. You can see here. A classic digoxin effects appears as a down sloping of ST segment depression. Normally, the T will be up like N or upside curve. So here it is the downward curve, that is known as reverse tick or reverse check sign. That is the peculiar feature of digoxin toxicity. Then fourth question, the blistering or sloughing of uninvolved skin when minimal pressure is applied in case of pemphigus is known as. The blistering or sloughing of the uninvolved skin when minimal pressure is applied in case of pemphigus is known as. Chadwick sign, Nikolsky sign, Cushing sign, Neri's sign. So here is the example. These are the uninvolved skin. While applying minimal pressure, the sloughing of the skin is occurs. So that sign is known as Nikolsky's sign. The blistering or sloughing of uninvolved skin when minimal pressure is applied in case of pemphigus, that is known as Nikolsky's sign. Pemphigus means it is a rare group of autoimmune disease. It causes blisters on the skin and mucous membranes throughout the body. It can affect the mouth, nose, throat, eyes and genitals. And pemphigus vulgaris is the most common type of pemphigus. Pemphigus vulgaris is the most common type of pemphigus. So it will affect mouth, nose, throat, eyes and genitals. In pemphigus vulgaris, usually it will be mouth, in skin and other genital area are the usual location of the blisters. And next, fifth question. Phocomelia is the teratogenic effect of which drug? Phocomelia is the teratogenic effect of which drug? Tetracycline, albendazole, thalidomide, chloramphenicol. Phocomelia means that long bones will be absent there and the distal part is attached to the, directly into the body. So here, hands, distal, proximal long bones are absent, and in legs also long bones, femur is absent, and the distal foot is directly attached to body. That condition is known as phocomelia. So that is it. That is due to some medication during the pregnancy. So which medication? Options: tetracycline, albendazole, thalidomide, chloramphenicol. So correct answer is thalidomide. Phocomelia is the teratogenic effect of which drug? That is thalidomide. Thalidomide is usually used for the treatment of multiple myeloma and leprosy. So if you are taking during the pregnancy this thalidomide, it will cause the phocomelia, that is absence of these long bonds. Phocomelia occurs through a severe shortening of the limbs due to the proximal elements, that is long bones, being reduced or missing and leaving distal elements in place. Thalidomide is used for the treatment of leprosy and multiple myeloma. I already told it is used for leprosy. Initially it is used for leprosy, but nowadays it is used for multiple myeloma treatment also. The proximal long bones are absent here and distal hand part is directly attached to the body. That condition is known as phocomelia. Next question, sixth one. Which of the following drug have disulfiram like action? Phenytoin, metronidazole, diazepam, midazole. Disulfiram actually it is used to stop the alcohol intake. If you are taking a very minimal amount of alcohol, if patient is on treatment with the disulfiram, it will cause facial redness, nausea, vomiting, dizziness, throbbing, headache and chest and abdomen discomfort. These symptoms is known as disulfiram like actions. So apart from disulfiram, if we are taking some of the given option, that that medicine will react with the alcohol in our body and produce the same symptoms. So you need to answer here. The correct answer is metronidazole. If you are having metronidazole after alcohol intake, it will cause same disulfiram like reactions. That is nausea, vomiting, flushing, dizziness, throbbing headache, chest and abdominal discomfort, and general hangover like symptoms. That symptoms are known as disulfiram like actions. If you are taking alcohol after metronidazole treatment, it will leads to these symptoms. Next question. Stenosis of foramen Leschke and Magendie is otherwise known as. Stenosis of foramen Leschke and Magendie is otherwise known as. Arnold Carey malformation, Dandy Walker syndrome, Wilson's disease, keratogenous syndrome. Stenosis of foramen Leschke and Magendie is otherwise known as. Correct answer is Dandy Walker syndrome. Dandy Walker syndrome means it is a brain malformation that occurs during embryonic development of the cerebellum and fourth ventricle. Dandy Walker syndrome means it occurs during the embryonic development of the cerebellum and fourth ventricle. Stenosis of foramen Leschke and Magendie. Next question. The clinic nurse is updating the medication being taken by an anxious middle-aged client and sees that the physician prescribed an antidiuretic hormone. The nurse knows the medication has which of the following effects on the kidneys. The clinic nurse is updating medications being taken by an anxious middle-aged client and sees that the physician prescribed an antidiuretic hormone. The nurse knows the medication has which of the following effects on kidney. It increases water reabsorption and urine concentration, decreases water deabsorption and dilutes the urine, regulates sodium retention, control potassium secretion. Correct answer is it increases water reabsorption and urine concentration. Antidiuretic hormone increases water reabsorption and urine concentration. Antidiuretic hormone that is produced by pituitary gland and it acts in the distal tubule and collecting ducts to increase water reabsorption and urine concentration. So if patient is taking antidiuretic hormone, the urine amount will be reduced because the urine from the distal tubule and collecting ducts, the urine will be reabsorbed and urine concentration will be high. So that is the action of antidiuretic hormone. Correct answer, increases water reabsorption and urine concentration. 10th question. The physician orders a CT scan of the client's chest with IV contrast. Which of the following findings in the client's history should the nurse report to the physician? The physician orders CT scan of the client's chest with IV contrast. Which of the following findings in the client's history should the nurse report to the physician? Hypertension, allergy to shellfish, urinary tract infection, allergy to penicillin. So here patient is getting CT chest with IV contrast. So here important term is IV contrast, and the nurse is taking history for finding out any contraindications. So here allergy to shellfish history. If patient is telling that patient has allergy to shellfish, that may be a contraindication for IV contrast, because a client with an allergy to iodine or shellfish may have an adverse reaction to the contrast medium. That is the important history findings. If patient is telling patient has allergy to shellfish, that may be leads to adverse reaction to the contrast medium. So this patient should not get IV contrast medium. and hypertension is not a contraindication for giving IV contrast. Urinary tract infection also not a contraindication. Same like allergy to penicillin also, there is no contraindication for giving IV contrast. Correct answer here, allergy to shellfish, because it will leads to adverse reaction to the contrast medium. Because shellfish usually contains iodine, that is why the contrast medium also will have iodine content. So if allergy to shellfish, that may be leads to reaction to IV contrast. 11th question, a nurse is assessing a client admitted with a cerebrovascular accident. The physician has ordered a swallow study. The nurse knows which of the following lobes of the cerebral hemisphere is involved in the control of voluntary muscle movement, including those necessary for the production of speech and swallowing. The nurse is assessing a client admitted with CVA. The physician has ordered a swallow study. The nurse knows which of the following lobes of the cerebral hemisphere is involved in the control of voluntary muscle movement, including those necessary for production of speech and swallowing. Frontal lobe, parietal lobe, temporal lobe, occipital lobe. Correct answer here, frontal lobe. So correct answer, the frontal lobe controls the production of speech and swallowing. The frontal lobe deals with higher levels of cognitive functions such as reasoning, judgment, and it also contains several cortical areas involved in the control of voluntary muscle movement, including those necessary for the speech and swallowing. So that is what asked in question. So here correct answer is frontal lobe. In the same case, parietal lobe is associated with sensation. Parietal lobe is associated with sensation and is involved in writing and some aspects of reading. Parietal lobe mainly associated with sensation and it is involved in writing and some aspects of reading. Temporal lobe is associated with auditory processing, olfaction, and word meaning. Parietal lobe is involved, associated with sensation, writing, and some aspects of reading. Temporal lobe is for auditory processing, olfaction, and olfaction means smelling, and word meaning. The same time, occipital lobe is involved in vision. Frontal lobe is voluntary muscle control, that is speech and swallowing also it is controlling. And the same time, parietal lobe is for sensation, involved in writing and some aspects of reading. Temporal lobe is associated with auditory processing related to hearing and also related to smelling, and then word meaning. These are the functions of temporal lobe. Occipital lobe's main function is vision, vision related control. Next question. Then a nursing home client is admitted to the hospital with a pressure ulcer involving full thickness loss extending to the bone. The nurse documents the pressure ulcer as being at which of the following stage? A nursing home client is admitted to the hospital with pressure ulcer involving full thickness loss extending to the bone. The nurse documents the pressure ulcer as being at which of the following stage? Stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, or stage 4. So here pressure sore or bed sore, it is extended up to bone and bone is exposed. So this is pressure sore is under stage 4. If full thickness skin loss and bone is exposed means that pressure sore is stage 4. From stage 1 means the skin will be intact and redness will be there. That is the first stage of bed sore or stage 1. In second stage means there will be a partial thickness loss of the dermis will be there. Second stage, the skin will be lost, that is partial thickness of the dermis will be lost. that cases stage 3, stage 2. In stage 3 means full thickness of dermis will be lost. That is stage 3, but in stage 3 the bone and muscle is not exposed. But in the case of stage 4, full thickness of dermis will be lost along with muscle and bone will be exposed. That is stage 4. Stage 1, there will be intact skin with redness. Stage 2 means partial thickness skin loss will be there. But in stage 3, full thickness dermis will be lost and muscle and bone will not be exposed in the case of stage 3. But in the stage 4, full thickness dermis will be lost along with muscle and bone will be exposed. 13th question. A client with Raynaud's disease is experiencing an acute attack. The nurse should anticipate which of the following assessment findings? Involuntary muscle contraction and twitching, unilateral facial weakness and drooping mouth, numbness and tingling of the fingers and blanching of the skin at the fingertips, photophobia. So you need to know what are the symptoms of Raynaud's disease. So here correct answer is option C, that is numbness and tingling of the fingers and blanching of the skin at the fingertips. In Raynaud's disease, there will be numbness and tingling of the fingers and blanching of the skin at the fingertips. The cause of the Raynaud's disease is still unknown. However, after exposure to the cold or stress, the client typically experiences blanching of the skin at the fingertips and numbness and tingling of the fingers. In the same time, involuntary muscle contractions and twitching is associated with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or ALS. Involuntary muscle contractions and twitching is associated with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis or ALS. In the same time, unilateral facial weakness and drooping of the mouth is seen in Bell's palsy. Unilateral facial weakness and drooping of mouth is seen in case of Bell's palsy. Then 14th question. The nurse is assessing a client with Addison's disease. The nurse expects to note which of the following. The nurse is assessing a client with Addison's disease. The nurse expects to note which of the following. Anorexia, weight gain, yellow skin coloration, a craving for sweets. Here, correct answer is option A, anorexia. The person feel hungry usually in very less free interval. After taking food and very less interval, the patient again feels hungry. And in the case of Addison's disease, there will be weight loss instead of weight gain. So Addison's disease, anorexia will be there, weight loss will be there, and skin color will be brown skin coloration. It is not yellow skin coloration. In case of Addison's disease, the skin color will change into brown skin. At the same time, the patients may have craving for salty foods. Instead of seeds, the patients have craving for salt content foods. And the Addison's disease, reason is for Addison's disease is adrenal deficiency, usually due to cortisol deficiency. Due to cortisol deficiency, that patients may have anorexia, weight loss, bronze skin coloration and a craving for salt content food, salt. Next question. A client is having a tonic-clonic seizure. Which of the following should the nurse do first? A client is having a tonic-clonic seizure. Which of the following should the nurse do first? Check the client's breathing. Remove objects from the client's surroundings. Place a tongue blade in the client's mouth. Restrain the client. So correct answer here, remove the objects from the client's surroundings. First intervention, if the patient is experiencing tonic-clonic seizure, the nurse should remove the objects from the client's surroundings. It will reduces injury to the patient. After the seizure episode stops, the nurse should check the client's breathing. And during the seizure, the nurse should not apply tongue blade to the client's mouth. It will cause injury to the patient. And restrain the client also will leads to injury to the patients. Sometimes it will leads to fracture itself. And first intervention, while having tonic-clonic seizure, that is, remove the objects from the client surrounding and make the client in a safe surroundings. First priority during seizure is protect the client from injury. To do this, the nurse must first remove the objects from the surroundings and pad objects that cannot be removed. If any objects that cannot be removed, then nurse should pad the objects with some soft cloth materials or something. It will leads to reducing injury. When the seizure stops, the nurse should check the breathing and if necessary, initiate rescue breathing. During the seizure process, do not need to assess the client's breathing. After the seizure episode only, the nurse needs to check the breathing. If it is necessary, nurse can initiate rescue breathing. So that is about today's video. 15 questions we discussed today. And if you have any doubt, means you can come ask in comment section. So I will try to answer your doubts. So thank you for watching this video. Please like and share this video. And also, if you are not subscribed, please subscribe. Thank you.